Hello and welcome to Off the Shelf Reviews.
I'm Ian.
And I'm Gary. And today we're going to take a trip to Mars, the Angry Red Planet, which is a film that came out in 1959. This takes us back to a time and place where civilization had only really just started discovering the moon or the other planets and starting to contemplate what is on those other planets. And of course, as we know as film lovers, there are a plethora of alien invasion movies ranging from comedies to horrors to body snatching to grotesque body mutilation aliens. We've seen it all. But the imagination back then was trying to come up and capture something. We didn't even know what the surface of Mars looked like.
Yeah.
So, I mean, this is also coming just after, I think, the War of the Worlds, which is pretty much one of the most iconic within its genre of aliens coming from another world. But this movie, it's about us going to Mars.
Yeah.
Ian, why don't you give us the synopsis for The Angry Red Planet?
Well, the film starts with a group of military men and scientists discussing the reappearance of a rocket, the MR-1, in the orbit of Mars. They use a computer signal to restart the engines of the rocket and get it to come back to Earth. When the rocket lands, they find that only two out of the four crew members are still alive and take the female crew member and get her to retell what happened to them. So we see what happened to the crew all in flashbacks.
That was a funny moment almost right at the beginning of the film when you have all these military personnel, and I got a feeling that the whole movie was going to be like that.
Yeah.
Not having any sort of knowledge about this movie going into it. And I laughed straight away when you've got all these men around all these terminals monitoring what's going on.
Yeah.
And then they go, there's a woman! And they all leg it, all of the men, right into their cars, jet into this capsule. I'm just like, what?
Monitors, stand by to check interior radiation.
Hold it, look!
Recovery squad, hold!
Someone's alive.
The girl!
The hell with radiation, let's go!
And that sort of theme or undercurrent of sexism,
oh yeah,
it is layered incredibly thickly in this movie. When we do cut to the flashbacks and we see this, you know, one female astronaut, a part of the crew,
yeah,
every single one of the guys on that ship starts hitting on her. It's day one for them in orbit and they're all making passes at her. And it's just like, yeah, this is definitely the late 50s, early 60s.
I enjoy these old movies, especially with the old use of stock footage, you know, especially when you've got all these guys sat around and they're waiting for the rocket to come back into orbit. So you're looking at all the stock footage of people working on consoles and stuff. But I absolutely love the fact that there were like two soldiers still outside and one of them goes, hey, look at that. And they're like, what? And this rocket is like thousands of fucking miles coming down from the atmosphere. And I'm like, how the fuck did you see that?
I just like all the little guys that are just in the background, just like twirling machines, pushing switches, and then looking like,
and did that do something?
It just definitely gave me that feel of like a Star Trek episode.
Yeah.
That sort of early sci-fi where everything is just very retro.
Yeah.
Although the set, it does kind of look like a basement that's just been stripped. It almost just looks, you know, like the hospital set, the spacecraft set. They all look like it was probably the same room.
The same
room. That was just changed over. But it's interesting to know that whilst they were making the film, the budget was, I think, it was cut in half and then cut in half again.
Yeah.
I think it was a budget of, what, $200,000?
Yeah.
Which is, you know, next to nothing for today's standards. But there is, you know, some genuine effort to make the sets believable. One of the biggest attractions about this movie, though, and if you go by the advertisements that went out there, is that this film is in Cinemagic.
Cinemagic is not being shown to you now, but this wild land comes alive in Cinemagic. You'll see buildings miles high in Cinemagic. Journey to the center of sudden terror in Cinemagic. Be trapped by the tentacles of man-devouring plants in Cinemagic. Feel the fire-hot breath of a 40-foot monster as it reaches for you in Cinemagic.
Cinemagic.
Cinemagic. Go to Mars in Cinemagic. Take off in Cinemagic. Ian, did I ever tell you what my favorite color is?
No.
Red. Was an accident. When they were processing the film, I think it got exposed twice, which caused this sort of weird sort of color red effect over the film, and also makes some of it sort of look transparent.
Yeah,
that was a genuine accident in the processing department, but the director was like, hey, wait a minute, that works. It gives it that alien feel. Tell you what, we'll use that for every single shot of Mars.
Oh god.
And it's for one pretty big particular reason, is that Mars is hand-drawn. Did you know that? Mars is all hand-drawn.
Our Iris, played by Nora Hader, she's retelling what happened. And so you go from the moment they're in orbit and they're talking about getting to the planet. And I love the fact they're looking out the window and they're like, look, the planet's over there. And I'm like, oh, but the ship would be...
I like the fact that they have a terminal which says forward.
It's like backwards. But they end up landing. They end up landing on the planet. And once again, they look out the window again at the planet. And they're like, you know, Mars is red. I'm like, yeah, well, you know, we all kind of figured that. Oh, there's vegetation as well.
Wait, really?
What?
With all that vegetation out there, there's bound to be something alive.
You mean like five-armed Angolas?
What?
Again, this is 20 years before mankind actually surveyed or charted what the surface of Mars would look like.
Yeah.
So this is, again, just... You know, that fantastical imagination is what's there. And the thing that gets me is that these are scientists, the best of the best, that are here. And they decide that they want to land sort of close to the equator belt.
Yeah.
Because they figured that that was the highest chance that they would have of encountering an alien life form.
Yeah.
Yet, once they decide to venture outside in the hopes of finding something... The main scientist asks which direction they think that the polar caps are going to be in. I'm like, you told them to get... Jesus Christ.
I got to bring up one thing that got me with this film. I love all these classic, these old classic sci-fi movies. Earth versus the Flying Saucer, The Forbidden Planet, The Day the Earth Stood Still, The Thing from Another World. They're all classics. But this one got me most because I couldn't shake... their shoes, right? I'm looking up, and there's a part where they're climbing up. I think it's Sam. Sam turns around with this absolutely brilliant line after he's finished with the telecommunication. He says,
"Hey, what's chow, huh? Coming up."
Wow, you would not get away with that nowadays. And she says to the colonel, "Look, you can come with me and help get the food ready," because obviously they've got some sexual tension between them. And they climb up a ladder, and she's got a pair of black flat shoes on, and he's got black flat shoes. And I'm like, are those NASA standard shoes? Do they help you walk around the shell?
Talking about NASA standard, they go out onto Mars in jumpsuits, and their visors. There's nothing there.
There's nothing there.
How was the oxygen getting past them? This is super tech. That's all I can put it down to.
Cleo, Sam's freeze gun.
Is that what it was?
Yeah, it was supposed to be a freeze gun.
Like it froze that plant early on, which they then managed to break.
It's just like beep.
Oh. 60s sound effects. This film is riddled with all of those things that you sort of are the bygone era of sci-fi movies.
Yeah.
It's the, you know, it's that sort of submarine sort of sound effect when they're in the shuttlecraft, or just that one pitched high note sort of noise that their guns make. It's very difficult to get through if you're not already in that sort of nostalgic, receptive mind to wanting to watch a movie like this.
Yeah.
Because these are classics for a reason.
Yeah.
And you've got to remember that this film is, what, 60 years old or, yeah, and more?
It's got some major flaws in it. I mean, like I said, it's not a classic, but if you're one of these people who loves the old 50s, 60s classic sci-fi movies, then you might get something out of it. But this is the bottom of the pile when it comes to films. I mean, it's like the moment they walk out onto the planet Mars, and like we said, everything is fucking red. I mean, my eyes were kind of hurting after a while. You know, I wanted them just to get back into the shuttle. But Iris is walking around, and she says to the colonel, you know, the colonel says, don't wander off too far. And she's like, oh, you know, don't worry, I'm just following this vine. I want to see where it goes. Okay, nobody follows her. You know, they're on an alien planet. There can be alien life forms around. Nobody bothers to help her. And she goes off to this plant, and the plant, this giant plant, tries to eat her, and you watch her wrap herself up. She wraps herself up in the tentacle, and then she's screaming like, help, help. Literally, she's walked like 3 steps away from the people, but the people are like, huh? Is something going on? I'm like, yes, she's fucking getting eaten. Go fucking rescue her. Sam comes along and he's like, beep.
Well, folks, in a monster movie or in a movie based on Mars, there's got to be something. There's got to be what they went there to discover. And I've got to tell you that the creature in this movie is magnificent.
Oh, yeah.
This is like a creature you have never seen before in any other movie. It's a combination of a spider, a mouse, bat, a rat,
spider legs.
The thing that gets me is that it's not even touching the floor. It's just sort of levitating, like, it's like a puppet string that you get, like, in a $2 store.
It's the build-up for it. They're like, look at those trees. Those trees are different. And you're like, oh, there's something wrong here. And, you know, she walks up, Iris walks up, and she bangs out, oh, it doesn't feel like bark. Colonel, hand me your machete. So the colonel gives a machete and she whacks the leg. And the creature's like, rah, gets all pissed off. And I'm like, I'd be pissed off being hit by a machete. But the thing that gets me is that all they had to do was look up.
Yeah.
And they would have seen its face.
Top scientists.
This thing starts attacking them. There's this whole dramatic sequence. And then you have to listen to Sam's gun for like 3 or 4 minutes. Just like, beep, beep. Not working, Colonel. I can't kill this thing.
Shoot it in the head.
Shoot it in the eyes. And he blinds the creature, and the creature goes,
blind it.
Aww. I felt sorry for it then. As it just slowly sort of backed away, like,
you passed it out and tried to say hello.
No wonder Martians attack us in every other movie. Well, at least, you know, that creature would go on to appear on a Misfits front cover. I guess it has some kind of lasting sort of memory and cinematic sort of history. But that's not to say that that's just one of the many creatures that do appear in this film.
Yeah.
Because after that, they get attacked by a giant amoeba. Now, if you don't know what an amoeba is, it's like a single cell sort of organism that it's never really any bigger than the size of a full stop. Whereas this amoeba is like the blob. And it literally it secretes this sort of acidic sort of residue so it can break down sort of any molecules to devour its prey. But this thing has like a Resident Evil eyeball.
Oh God, I love its eyes. The way its eyes spin around are fucking good.
It's just the one eye and it just spins and spins and spins. I'm like, Jesus Christ, that thing's going to be so dizzy. As it's trying to chase them. It's like, I see them, it's gone. Where did they go? Oh, I see them. Oh, where'd they go? Oh, I see them again. But that does bring us to a gory death scene.
Yeah, I don't really have a favourite scene in this movie, but I do have one scene that kind of quite upset me. I was getting behind the characters after a while. I mean, the fact you've got Iris, or Irish, as the Colonel calls her, all the way through the film. That's a really rapey scene, actually, where the Colonel says to Iris, when I call you by your name, you'll know it.
I felt really uncomfortable during... I mean, this is like the opening sort of 10 minutes of the film, and I'm like, is this what this film's about? Is it going to go then? It's going to be a psychological rape fest where she's going to be fending off against these deranged Neanderthal-reduced men.
You know, Irish, you're the first scientist I've ever known with lovely, long red hair.
And you're the first pilot I've ever gone to Mars with. And listen, my name is Iris, not Irish. I never know if you're calling me by name or nationality.
When I call you by name, you'll know it.
I was really getting behind the characters, and Sam, I was really starting to warm up to, you know, he was kind of a bubbly fellow, he was reading comic books, he was kind of all happy. And then, in a really shitty fashion, actually, he gets pulled away by the space amoeba and ends up inside it. And they're watching, they're stood at the door, the three characters are stood at the door watching him as he's inside its belly, melting. And I'm like, Sam, no!
Well, you never actually see him melting, but you see all that red, blue, crystal gunk up against the visors of the ship. So I was like, okay, so I'm guessing he's being slowly digested, and that's just his remains.
Remains.
I was like, you know what? It's when your imagination gets wrapped up in it, it's really disgusting. We've seen the real horror in special effects of those things.
Yeah.
You don't really need to see it in this movie. But it's enough there suggested to know that that's really a horrible way to go.
Yeah, definitely.
Then we also have perhaps my favourite creature of the movie. And it, at first I was like, no, please. It looks like flipping Mac from Mac and Me, just hiding behind the rocks. It's like a little fucking devil. So you never actually get to see the alien. And when you do, it's sort of like got this ripple warp defect on it. As it's sort of voyeuristically looking through the windows of the craft.
This film, I do actually feel that this film would have been better as just a TV kind of episodic adventure. There are so many blackout cuts through the film that after a while they just seemed out of place. You know, I understand that sometimes you fade from scene to scene and you fade in and out of scenes. But it's like they actually faded out while somebody was talking. As he finished the sentence, it'd gone black and they were on to the next scene. So I was just like, that shouldn't be in the film. That should have been like the end of the episode. And then we'd have come back the next week to find out what happened to the characters. That would have been so much better. As a film, nah.
I don't particularly have one favorite scene in this film. It was, I will be honest, it was a bit of a chore to get through. I did sort of doze off in the middle section. But if I had to choose a favorite scene, it would probably be the scene where the amoeba is chasing them across the river when they're just paddling away. I kind of got a real sort of, even though like the sizing of the superimposed image didn't work too well. I kind of got some sort of sense of danger from that creature, especially considering it was submerged under the water. You couldn't really see what it was, and that there gave me some sort of genuine chills.
Yeah.
So that there would probably be my favorite moment. I can't really recommend The Angry Red Planet. It is a product of its time, and if it's a film that you're sort of revisiting, then you already know what you're getting in for. But as if you're a first-time viewer, you could only really watch this sort of on a lazy sort of Saturday afternoon, when you're really hungover, or perhaps when you're having movie marathons, sort of things to go on in the background, just something that, or for people just to have a look at and have a chuckle. And just to see, you know, what we perceived with our imaginations, what life could be like on Mars.
Yeah.
Other than the fact that we now know that it's a barren, dead planet. Well, but still, the imagination has captivated us all throughout time about Mars.
Yeah.
And that infatuation with that planet, it's never going to go away. One of the things that this film does is, with its ending, it sort of layers in a very heavy message.
Yeah.
Now, this is something that was pretty much encapsulates the day the Earth stood still.
Yeah.
It's the message that this alien, the superior alien race, is delivering us to mankind. And again, it also reminds me of like the end of The Abyss.
Yeah.
Where the alien creatures are like, look, we've been watching you this whole time. You've done fucked up.
You done fucked up.
You continue to do so, and we're just going to obliterate you completely. So go back to your own planet. Tell the rest of humankind to mature. Your technology's matured, but you, as human beings, have not. I think it's a very important message.
Yeah.
And seeing it even then, all the way back then in these movies, it might be sort of laying on a bit thick, but sometimes you have to, because some people are dumb. I will say it. The alien species in these movies are normally correct. And that message, it's still worth hearing today. So, even though it is a bit ham-fisted and over the top, I think that it could make or break the movie for you, because it has been done before.
Yeah.
But it still works in the context of this movie.
Do as you will to your own and to your planet, but remember this warning. Do not return to Mars. You will be permitted to leave for this sole purpose. Carry the warning to Earth. Do not come here. We can and will destroy you, all life on your planet, if you do not heed us.
I like Gary, I don't really recommend this to filmgoers nowadays. You know, you only watch this film if you're wanting to watch a classic sci-fi movie. There are better classic sci-fi movies out there. War of the Worlds, Forbidden Planet, The Thing from Another World, It Came from Outer Space. You know, like I said, this one is like, on a list of top 10, this is at least a 15, you know, pushing a 20. At the same time, it does open the door to show us why we should A, never go back to Mars, B, why there are probably hell monsters, and, you know, why Tim Robbins got lost on Mars as well. You know, there's just reasons we should never fuck with that planet. It's because it's angry and really red.
Thanks for watching Off the Shelf Reviews.